Dr. Carson, does the New Testament teach justification by the imputation of Christ's righteousness?
Yes. I want to say yes, certainly, but it needs some nuance. I don't want to say that's all that is involved in imputation. I certainly don't want to say that that's all there is in justification. For our sins are reckoned, imputed, laid on, calculated to Him, and He cancels them, He expiates them as He turns God's favor toward us. But at the same time, I would argue that Christ is made not only our wisdom, but also our righteousness before God. And this is itself bound up with a bigger theme in the New Testament that insists we are so identified with Christ that just as our sins are reckoned to Him and His righteousness is reckoned to us, the whole basis of our acceptance before God, of God declaring us that we are just, is tied to this union with Christ. And then, too, I would also want to add, justification is not to be identified with all of salvation. Salvation is the bigger category, and it includes, for example, new birth and ultimate consummation and so forth. Justification is bound up with what makes us acceptable before God. God declares us just, and thus the final verdict that one would have thought He would have given at the last day is already passed on us right away, who are His people, on the basis of what Christ has already done. And in that sense, it is not all of salvation, but it is the crucial entry point in our experience to salvation. And Luther was not far off when he said that it is the doctrine which is the test of the church. Of course, he was thinking particularly in his own times when the Roman Catholic medieval view was far removed from this. And so that became for him a supreme test. But it is important to see that what is at stake is not just the word justification, but what makes us acceptable before God, because what is involved in our lostness is first and foremost our alienation before God. And so justification is the means by which God has declared us just and thus reconciled us to Himself. And that itself is bound up with our identity with Christ, our union with Christ, such that His righteousness is mine and my sin is His, and He cancels it and pays for it.
What aspect of our salvation are we still waiting for future fulfillment or the future appropriation?
The obvious thing, obviously, is resurrection body. People sometimes say, is there healing in the atonement? And some from non-charismatic backgrounds say, no, of course not. And I would say, obviously, there is healing in the atonement, just in the same way that there is resurrection in the atonement. But just because the atonement has paid for things, including resurrection existence, which presupposes all healing, completely, forever, it doesn't mean that we have it all now. I have not yet met any Christians wandering around the place with resurrection bodies. And so that clearly is yet to come. But with this resurrection body also comes such perfection that we will no longer be tempted by sin, and for us sin will be inconceivable. We will love God with heart and soul and mind and strength. We will love our neighbors as ourselves. We will be morally without fault experientially, not merely in our legal standing before God. So obviously that's the biggest thing. But on the other hand, as we move toward that goal, there is increasing appropriation of the grace of God as we learn further lessons in obedience and repentance and contrition and hating of sin, mortification of sin, to use the King James word. So in that sense, there is place for growth in holiness and so on as well, which is still to be part of our inheritance. The irony is that the more you grow in holiness in this fallen, broken, damned world in which the flesh still wars against the spirit, the more you're aware of your own sin. The irony is that the more holy you get, the more you realize you're not holy. And for that reason, we cry all the more, longingly with the church in every generation, even so come, Lord Jesus.